assume that publicly, but I know I am a learned colleague in private, because they come and they shake me and they say, VC, Nibu, learned colleague. But in public, they deny me. So I accede. I recognize my wonderful brother, who is also of that extraction, Soken Wong. I must recognize all lawyers, I have them left, right, center. Lawyers. The minute past Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration, who is my current SABC on legal matters, then Professor Carol Arenzo Mobi. And he's also a lawyer. So the lawyer Baramburuburu. So by all definition, I should be a learned colleague. Either by induction or otherwise, I should be a learned colleague. You know, in those days there are universities where when they look at you, you dress like a professor, you speak like a professor, you walk like a professor. They call you professor. So having mingled with lawyers in and out, I think I deserve it publicly now, not in private. Yes, I recognize my chief legal officer, who is also internal member of council, a lawyer also. So you see lawyers, the lawyer thing is coming out clearer. So Professor Mishak Enomueke, thank you very much. I must doff my cap for the emeritus professors here, former deputy vice chancellors. Obueshi Anomekenego, Obueshi Gunabo, Anomekenege, and Professor Wanda, Anomekenege, Federal Madale, thank you. They are always here for our inaugural lecture, so I thank them. Yes, the past provost of Federal College of Technical Umunze, another Joseph, Joseph at Obuago. I thank you for welcoming. Yes, the deans of faculties who are here, the dean of medicine and the other deans. And dean of medicine, I salute you in a special way for the wonderful support. And all the wonderful staff and students of our Faculty of Law, I welcome you all to this 94th inaugural lecture. It's a great thing, it's a thing of joy to listen to lawyers speak again. It's always good to listen to them. And as I was speaking, the CJ of Anambra State, yes, the Attorney General of Anambra State, yes, just walked in. And I recognize also a professor of law, and the immediate past Attorney General also of Anambra State. I cited that she's here. Yes, you are welcome. So the lawyers, you people have the day, and I respectfully acknowledge you people. The 94th inaugural lecturer, yes, Professor Felicia Azuoma, it is not by coincidence that you are the 94th inaugural lecturer. And I want to respectfully tell this audience that when we started the inaugural lecturer series, as when I was vice chancellor, we're just barely at number 44th or the 45th. And I turned back today as I was trying to reminisce over the speed with which we have moved. And I saw that we have doubled that number. We have doubled that number. And they have added Jara. So Professor Felicia Anyogu, you are the Jara on top of the doubling. And I want to appreciate you for that. You came at the very right time, you know. So when we talk about two plus, double plus, I will always remember your inaugural lecture. And I thank your husband, who I heard, I don't know him so closely, but people have attested to the kind of support and the waves he moved as the former Dean of Law. So, Prof. Anamekenege, Nuzopuriche. Thank you for supporting our sister Felicia, yes, to ascend to this very prestigious height. Today, as we know, is a very important day, and we are trying to bring out our masquerade. We produce them here, and they have been working in diverse ways, professing, so to say. But today, they are trying to showcase to us, telling both the town and the county why, what necessitated are making them professors. And the particular contributions they have been making in terms of knowledge, and it's presented in a very layman's language, so that even the uninitiated, or people like us who are already learned colleagues, those who are uninitiated, they will understand. So today we are going to listen to this erudite professor of law and talking on something very topical. And if you, I read the topic, I started picking out the keywords there, and I discovered amazingly that every single word in that topic is a keyword. Every single word there is a keyword. The word torpedo itself tells you that we are in for something very dramatic today. You know that, and look at the human genital. All of them are keywords. I know what it means in Igbo, but the way as lawyers they will present it, you want to listen to how it will be dissected. And that's why we are excited that both the town and the Ghana are here today to listen to this erudite professor tell us the ills associated with this practice and the way forward, what the law has to say. I'm not preempting the lecture, but I'm really excited to listen to this lecture, as every other lecture that we've been having in our inaugural lecture series. Want to encourage and appreciate our online audience. The online audience have been most wonderful. They give us very positive feedbacks that has encouraged us to do more in terms of inaugural lecture. You may not know that we get feedbacks from them. I, for one, I get several feedbacks from some of the people who are online. Some of them comment. We have some regular people who are in the United States, in Canada, some of them in some parts of Africa. After each inaugural lecture, they will send a message and say, today's own was wonderful. Today's own was so. But what of this? And sometimes they want to, you know, inadvertently draw me into debate on discussing the inaugural lecture. I say, well, inaugural lecture is not for discussion. Once Professor Anyogu mounts this podium, whatever she says, even the Vice Chancellor cannot stop her. She's entitled to opinion. And if you are debating the veracity otherwise of whatever she says, it's not for the Vice Chancellor to discuss privately. But it tells you that the lecture series we have, the inaugural lectures, are attracting a lot of online attention, and people sometimes call my attention and want to discuss them, usually on a very positive note, you know, trying to explain what they're doing. So I anticipate again that today will be another of such days. So we look forward to a very exciting lecture coming from this erudite professor of law, and I enjoin all of us to sit back, relax, and make time to take notes, food for thoughts after this lecture. On this note, therefore, it's my pleasure and singular honor to declare the 94th inaugural lecture open. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chancellor. Thank you so much. Please, another round of applause for him. Mr. Chairman, sir, distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, we want to introduce our big masquerade this afternoon. But I would like to call on the right person that will do that. And today we are privileged to have a professor to perform this very all-important, presentation. Distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, may I humbly invite Professor Nkechi Okpalobi. Professor Okpalobi is a professor of private and public law, Nnamdi Azikiwe University, Awka, to present the citation on the inaugural lecturer.
Vice Chancellor Nnamdi Azikiwe University, Professor Charles Okechukwu Esimone, may I crave your indulgence to stand on the already established protocol. And it is my privilege and my honor and with great joy that I present the citation of a wonderful friend, and the Professor of Laws, Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, with your kind permission, may I request the 94th inaugural lecturer to step forward to take her citation. Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu, PhD, LLM, BL, LLB Honours, BSc Chemistry Honours, Fellow, Corporate Administrations Institute, is a global and human rights icon, a crusader of women's rights, an Amazon of legal narratives. She's a professor of cognitive potency, a jigsaw puzzle that you cannot unravel. And from her topic, Torpedoing, the genital traumatism, at the end of the lecture, this August audience will be able to tell us whether she's been able to do that, to unpuzzle this topic. She's a jigsaw puzzle in chemical equations because she has taught chemistry for over 25 years. Yes. And in my own testimony, I had a daughter who was in secondary school. She found chemistry so difficult. And I just told her, I didn't know that she taught chemistry. She said, in 5 lectures, I'll be able to unravel the mystery. And I tell you that after those 5 lectures, my daughter made an A1 in chemistry. Yes. I thank you for that. The 94th inaugural lecturer. She is a teacher of teachers, a formator, a mentor, a mother of doctors, of lawyers, engineers, pharmacists, professors, to mention but a few. She is a philanthropist par excellence. She takes school fees of children, more than 50 of them. A superstar. And above all, a noble and worthy advocate. At times, I am tempted to liken her to the Holy Spirit because of what she did in my life. She is a comforter, a counselor. Sometimes she will need to spank me some 10 years ago. Nkechi, you must be alive. And today, Mr. Vice Chancellor, I'm alive to perform this function in her life. And I thank God and I return all the glory to God. To me, she is a woman with a golden heart. Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu was born in Takoradi in Ghana to her lovely parents of the blessed memory. A pretty damsel, a second child of the family. The father looked at her and said, this girl is so pretty that she must have a formal education. And that made the father to enroll her in the prestigious Bishop Orok Middle High School. As a small girl, primary school. And in secondary school, she attended the famous St. Louis Girls Secondary School, Kumasi. Yes. And there she also went back to do her high school, where she got her high school. She's an alumnus of great University of Nigeria, a lioness. 2 times. She did her BSc chemistry there and also studied law there. She's an alumnus of great UNISIC, the University of the Moment, LLM and PhD respectively. She is a legal practitioner and a solicitor of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, having attended the Nigerian Law School and was called to the legal bar in 2000. Mr. Vice Chancellor, she is not called to the legal bar, but the legal bar, yes. She has gathered a lot of relevant experience over the years, and she rose through the ranks as an assistant lecturer in 2002, lecturer 2, 2004, lecturer 1, 2007, senior lecturer 2010, associate professor of laws 2013, and professor of laws in 2016. She's counsel in chambers and partner Ezesi Anyogu and Co. The Dean Emeritus, thank you so much. She has taught in Nnamdi Azikiwe for over 18 years, and in these years, she has been researching, teaching, and supervising. She has supervised over 150 undergraduate students, about 30 LLM and PhD together. She has taught and developed the course curriculum for postgraduate international human rights law, the area of law where she did her PhD and which she's going to take today. She also developed curriculum for women and minority rights, part of the committee that did that, law of equity and trust, constitutional law, banking and insurance law, advocacy to mention but a few. Professor F.A. Anyogu has over 86 published works. 2 textbooks to her credit, 2 co-authored textbooks, over 6 chapters in books, 38 published work in indexed and peer-reviewed journal called Google Scholar, 41 published works in international journals and local journals. She attended over 90 conferences and workshops and had presented about 40 papers in these conferences. She's been in the United States of America presenting papers over 12 times. The Gambia, Senegal, Ghana, Nigeria, to mention but a few. F.A. Anyogu is an academic leader, having worked as an exam officer under the watch of the Honorable Attorney General when the Attorney General was the chief exam officer. Later, she took over from her as the chief of the faculty, CP coordinator, external assessor to many universities, Open University, Delta State University, Enugu State University of Science and Technology, Lagos State University, University of Uyo, University of Abuja, University of Nigeria, Enugu Campus, till date. She is an editor-in-chief to so many journals. I just want to mention a few. Editor-in-chief, the frontline publication of International Federation of Women Lawyers. Editor-in-chief, Journal of Women and Minority Rights, a publication of the Consortium of Women Lawyers in Academics. Editor, Journal of Commercial and Property Law of our great university. Editor, Women, Education and National Development in Africa, a Federation of University Women of Africa publication. She is the editor, multidisciplinary or co-editor, the disciplinary essays in honor of Professor Boniface Ebuka. Editor, Nigerian Journal Maiden Edition. Editor, Global Review Journal. Editor, Asian Women Journal. Editor-in-chief, University-led Knowledge and Innovation for Sustainable Development. She's into a lot of consultancy jobs, reports, and representations. She's been a member of team of consultants for the development of draft curriculum for the Nigerian universities. Member of the team for the harmonization and validation of the analytical study on identification of gender discriminatory provisions and gender equality gaps in the national laws of ECOWAS member states. Member of team of consultants for the baseline study of the level of compliance with the Anambra Administration of Criminal Justice Law. Led up legal defenses and assistance projects, British Council, funded by DFID. Expert representative at the presentation of the articulation of current laws that promote the rights of women and girls in the Southeast, and part of it is what she's going to do today. It is a DFID project in collaboration with MacArthur Foundation. Coordinator, Enugu Access to Justice for Indigenous Women Project. It's a feeder project in conjunction with French Embassy under the umbrella of the DFID. facilitator paralegal training of trainers for the access to judges, justice for indigenous women, representative of stakeholders, presenting the standoff feeder at the public hearing for the passage of the Child's Right Bill before the Enugu State House of Assembly. She is a resource person in various radio programs on gender rights issues and laws, sponsored by WINET, CPN, and FIDA. Resource person on several advocacy outreaches by FIDA and Women for Women. She has gathered a lot of administrative experience over the years. She's been a director, Center for Sustainable Development. She's been the sub-dean of the faculty, faculty representative to the University Senate. She's been the head of department, public and private law, member Interior Decoration Committee, Faculty of Law, member Faculty of Law Equipment Purchasing Committee, CP coordinator of the faculty, chairperson or chairman, monthly colloquium, Faculty of Law, and chairman, Office Allocation Committee. She's also in the Vice Chancellor's Committee of this great university. She has been the Member Legal Advisory Committee of Great UNISIC, Deputy Coordinator, Certificate and Diploma Programs, Exam Monitoring and Resource Submission, UNISIC, Member Committee for Development of Postgraduate Curriculum in Migration Studies, Member Committee on Review of National Universities Commission Benchmark Minimum Academic Standards, the BIMAS document, Member Legal Advisory Committee in Nnamdi Azikiwe University, Member Needs Assessment Committee, and Member Inaugural Lecture Committee Series 2023. She has equally contributed a lot to university and the society, and has bagged a lot of awards. She attracted a grant of over 5 million naira to the faculty through the estate of late Johnny Okonkwo SN to the faculty at his demise. Advocate of Ladies of Semolumba Enugu South Council, Vice President, Catholic Women Organizations, Christ the King Parish Enugu, Legal Advisor, Christ the King Catholic Parish Enugu, Legal Advisor, Igbo Women Forum Enugu Chapter, Regional Treasurer, Federation of Women, of University Women in Africa, an affiliate of International Federation of University Women. She's been the Secretary, International Federation of Women Lawyers, FIDA, and I hope FIDAs, you're here. Secretary, Vice President, National Association of University Women, UNISIC Chapter, Chairperson, International Federation of Women Lawyers, FIDA Enugu Branch, where she has done a lot of advocacy, mediation, and mainstreaming girls and women into the correct order. Award of Excellence, she's been the National Council of Women's Society, have bagged the award. She's been the best student in oral English and written English in her secondary school. She's the chairman, Continuing Legal Education, International Federation of Women Lawyers, Vice President of the Ladies of Semolumba Enugu Sub Council up till date. Lastly, she is the chairman, Continuing Legal Education Committee of FIDA Nigeria. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, at this juncture, and with profound respect, I present an unassumingly erudite professor of law, Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu.
I'm just reminiscing. How did we even get here? It was in 1978 when my family, my parents of Mbise roots and Abu, two neighboring towns. We came back from Ghana, and then I had my WASC and my higher school certificate. When we came back here, we found out you didn't need higher school to go to university, but in Ghana you do. So I took the second jump because we came back in 1978. And then I think things also worked in Nigeria. So after the exam, Jamb wrote to me, telling me I was successful. A little while later, University of Nigeria wrote to me, giving me admission. So that saw me at University of Nigeria in Soka, reading chemistry with education bias. Yes. So that was in 79. So in 1983, I graduated with BSc honors. Within this time, I had met my heart. I had married him. Before I came out from that school, I already had a child in tow. Yes. So, but when he married me, he now asked me to withdraw from chemistry. I said no, for two reasons. One is that I was a core science student, and I thought withdrawing at that point was a waste of effort, so I finished it. Then I said I was going to do please him to read law. The second reason was I like to finish whatever I start. So I finished it and then went into law. I started teaching chemistry in secondary school, exam classes all through. I have a lot of doctors, engineers, and so on and so forth. So, thank you. So, in 1998, I finished reading law. Went to law school, was called to the Nigerian Bar. I lost 2 years reading law, one to ASU, the other one to the extension. Law was now 5 years instead of 4 years. Yes. So at law school, I applied to do a master's. So when we got back after the law school and called to bar, I saw a lot of my lecturers, and they were my name was number two. They were asking me, when are you coming to register? I said, I'm coming. Then I met Dr. Ilochoka. Now Professor Ilochoka, the former vice chancellor. So he said that he has heard I was going back to my school, that I should go to Awka and get a form. I guess he had plans for Awka. So somehow, strangely, I obeyed him. So I went and took out the form to do master's here. A while later, I think the law faculty was undergoing accreditation from the Council of Legal Education. So they needed teachers. And we were five of us that were recruited. First reason is that we had a degree elsewhere. The second reason is that we were doing masters already. Now, myself, the Attorney General, Professor Ifemeke, the Dean, Professor Igbeze, Professor Godwin, well, he had a master's at the time. And then Professor Angela Obidima, five of us. That was in 2002. So we rose through the ranks. We now found out we had to do PhD if we're going anywhere at all. So I continued. I continued, and here we are. So that's where we are. That's how. Vice Chancellor, sir. Former Vice Chancellor, sir. DVC, Chair President, I think he has left. Special Advisor to the Vice Chancellor, Academic Matters. Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration. Okay. Special Advisor to the Vice Chancellor on Legal Matters. Members of the University Governing Council, the Librarian, the Registrar, the Bursar, Deans of Faculties and Directors, Provost of the College of Colleges of Health Science and Postgraduate Studies, distinguished professors, heads of departments, distinguished academic and professional colleagues from other universities, my Lord spiritual and temporal, gentlemen of the prayers, distinguished members of the Faculty of Law. Good afternoon, everybody. What we're going to talk about today, in fact, I don't know whether it's an advocacy, whether it's a sensitization effort, whatever it is still academic. What we're going to talk about is something that many people know. Some don't believe it. Some believe it, they don't care. Some think it's not even important. Some think that's what it should be. That's where they should be. They are only meant to suffer the after effects and then take care of our babies and all that. Some have died for it, and some have suffered untold misery for it. A very basic limitation to the enjoyment of human rights by women, old and young, on equal basis with men, is a clash between the human rights concerns and the cultural and traditional observations. Article 12 of ICESCR says that everybody has the right to attain the highest possible standard of health. But in the area of course, that has to do with, or that enhances the rights of women and satisfying sex life, you dictate how many kids you want, who you want the kids with, what you want to do, the spacing and all that. But in the area of satisfying sex life, culture has put a stricture on women. Well, it would seem as if the problem of women, the ordeal of women, knows no bound and no age. This was legally postulated in the case of People Rel and Son, where it was stated that the court cannot regulate by its process internal affairs of the home. However, when there is a moral, emotional problem that will go to the child, then the court can take the step of the parent and dictate what should be done with the child. In that case, a man and his wife were living together, incapacitated. The man was the one moving about. They had a small daughter called Jennifer. Now, the man was in a cult, not the cult that we know. It's a religious cult called Megiddo. They believe what the Bible says, and they interpret it as it is written. But that is not the problem. They were very good Christians. But leisure had no place in their lives. Government work had no place in their lives. You don't attend public schools because they are owned by government. If you are going to Megiddo school, that is even better, where practicable. Now, this man had charge of their daughter, and that Megiddo meeting was held in another town. So the child was always taken away to that place to attend Megiddo and to be fed with these things. Marriage was not encouraged. Procreation was not a priority, even for married people. And Christmas is just an event. It's not meant to be celebrated. And that girl was always taken away from the love of the mother, which she needed. So that was where the court now said, no, there is harm being done to the girl. And therefore, the court decided to give custody of that girl to the mother. That was how she took her child, and they lived a normal life. There's another case, Prince and Massachusetts. There was a law in a state that says children should not sell. Labor is not for children. So whatever you give a child to go and sell is a criminal offense, once it's a child. So if you give a child tracts, religious tracts, to go and sell, it doesn't hold, because it has nothing to do with right of a religious practice. So in that case, that was what happened. And the court said that parents can make matters of themselves, but you cannot make matters of your children. You allow them to grow up and decide that they want to be matters. Before we go on, I guess we'll have to look at some conceptual framework. Let us unravel the meanings to some of these words we have here. What is torpedo? The thing is torpedoing. Torpedoing the human rights aberration in genital trauma, masculinizing the purpose. What is a torpedo? Torpedo is a missile, a deadly missile, destroying an enemy ship through a submarine or through an aeroplane. So whatever needs to be torpedoed is an enemy of the world. Now, what is human right? A right that is moral, correct. It's a legal or moral entitlement. These are basic rights that people have because of their humanity. If anybody violates your human rights, the person is telling you are not a human being. That's the simple truth, that you are not a human being. Now, this talk about human rights started during the Renaissance humanism era. The idea of human rights ushered in the Renaissance, which then brought in the League of Nations, which now saw to the drafting of the United Declaration of Human Rights. This HR said we all have inherent dignity in the human family, that we are all born free and equal, and we are all entitled to rights without distinction of race, sex, religion, etc. Now, what is genital traumatism? A trauma is a very stressful occasion, frightening or distressing event. And development or occurrence of it is traumatism. Within the ambit of our discourse, genital traumatism is a trauma that is given to the genitals, focused on the genitals, dealing with the genitals. So even as you are sitting down, I know you can imagine where this trauma is in your own genital, whether you are man or woman. Some adherents of this genital traumatism, I've likened it to the circumcision without adverting their minds to the fact that the male circumcision is not as held, doesn't give much risk, health risk, as much as the female one. In fact, it beautifies the organ. Yes, because if a man comes to you as a woman and the foreskin is not removed, you'll be reluctant to have anything to do with him. Okay. This genital traumatism takes the form of excision of the clitoral hood, excision of part or all of the clitoris. I want you to, that's why I said, I don't know if it's advocacy, campaign, sensitization. Use your mind. You've seen a clitoris before. Imagine where it's being chopped off. From a small child without anesthesia. All right? Then removal of part or all of the external genitalia and stitching it. That one is called infibulation. Then some of us present here are guilty of the fourth one. We have sat down to watch our mothers use powder to rub on the clitoris of our daughters. Some of us have also done it. What? Think about the reason. Why are you doing it? Since you have decided not to be with the other people that will use a crude method to do it, why are you still doing it? You are doing it because she is not supposed to enjoy sex as much as a man. So you want to discipline that clitoris. You use powder and you rub it. And then some will use a hot water and press it down, go down. You know, go down. She's not supposed to enjoy it. So, these are the things we do. So, if you are here and you've been doing it, henceforth, no rubbing, no pressing. Don't ever. In fact, we're bleeding. I told you it's an advocacy campaign. All right. We also, there's an extension of the keywords, there is a hymn here. The hymn will be all the male stakeholders. Could be a father, a brother, a husband, a prospective husband. And the hers are the victims, the women. Justification for this paper. Okay. In 2007, there was a report on female genital mutilation where they said, though FGM is practiced in more than 280 countries in Africa, its burden is seen in Nigeria, Egypt, Mali, Central African Republic, Eritrea, Sudan, and northern part of Ghana. The highest prevalence rates are found in Somalia and Djibouti. In Nigeria, at the time of that study, the Southeast was 68%, Southwest 62%, and North was the smallest. I think the South-South had the highest number of FGMs. The population at this time was about 150. With women forming 52%, and the national prevalent rate of FGM was 41% among adult women. A look at the prevalence in the last decade and a half is indeed a pointer to the necessity for this work. In 2008, the rate was 41% of a population of about 150 million, made up of 52 women. The total number of women was then 78 million. And out of this, 41% went through female circumcision, making it an absolute numerical number of 31.98 million. In 2013, between 2008 and 2013, it declined to 27%. But then it increased for children 0 to 14 years. So even the younger ones now had a higher rate of it. The other ones are people who were from 15 years to 49. You know, theirs declined. So the new ones, showing that the thing was still happening. So that's why we feel that it is necessary for us to, you know, torpedo it, not just sensitize people to stop it or terminate it. Torpedo it, kill it beyond. Right. Another study in United Kingdom and Exeter. They said, according to the study by researchers from universities of Birmingham, United Kingdom, and Exeter, FGM accounts for more deaths in these countries than any cause other than enteric infections, malaria, contaminated food or water, or respiratory infections. While they called for it to be made illegal in Chad, Mali, Malawi, Sierra Leone, and Liberia, they also called for efforts to eliminate it in countries where it was practiced, and Nigeria is one of them. Now, relevance under medical and legal and cultural. I don't know, when you are discussing this, whether we should take a sober mood, whether we should take an aggressive mood, or whether we should just plead, see the danger, and stop. Now, medically, this practice is irrelevant. They can have hemorrhage, reproductive tract infections, pelvic inflammations, hepatitis B, and even HIV/AIDS, as one unsterilized needle goes from one victim to the other. Legality, it is illegal because the consent of the victims is never sought. Some people do it when they are about to get married, like the Bibio people. That consent, I am sure, is never, it's undue influence. They are forced to do it. They may tell them that your husband will not marry you, or that it has been so culturally accepted that it's a taboo for you to even voice out any refusal. Culturally, it reinforces the culture put forward for its practice. Because culturally, they said it is so that the girl will not be promiscuous. What do you mean by promiscuous? They are just doing this thing to protect the property of the man in a woman. And what is discrimination? This is the root of discrimination. There are two sexes. The types of April Ashley are not within the ambit of this discourse. So we're talking about natural men and women, born men and women. So we are just two, men and women. So why won't I enjoy it? Why should I not enjoy it? God created it, that we should make children from it. You want me to take only the suffering part? After, I'll go and carry the baby and suffer for 9 months and beyond, because you still have to nurse the child. Okay? Now, the cultural reason is that they don't want women to be promiscuous. But when a girl gets, and he doesn't, she doesn't enjoy it. Naturally, she may want to find out whether it's her fault or her husband's fault. So if she is that way inclined, she may go to man number two. And then after that, she'll just say, it's just one man more. Let me try another person. She goes there. When somebody is married and she has slept with two other men, what do you call that? So that cultural reason for it has failed. Okay. Now, legal abrasions. The female genital cutting is a human rights issue. It's just a simple human rights issue. Cultural reflection of deep-rooted inequality between the sexes. It constitutes extreme form of discrimination against the females. Now, the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria from inception has always contained chapters on the protection of human rights. When the white man came to live, the minorities were not sure of surviving with the rest of us. So they asked for another state. And a committee was set up. That committee, instead of giving them the state, now asked for human rights chapters to be inscribed into the constitution. And that was how the 1963 constitution had human rights. And from then on, all our constitutions have contained human rights chapters up to the 1999 constitution as amended. It's in chapter 2 and chapter 4. Chapter 2 is made non-justiciable by the same constitution. Chapter 4 is the civil and political rights. And the constitution has made provision for human rights where some issues, though not directly touching on FGM, can be construed from it. And the constitution, being the grand norm, is the apex law of the land. Every other law takes their validity from the constitution. If you don't agree with the constitution, you are invalid to the extent of your not agreeing with the constitution. Now, female circumcision contravenes the following rights. Right to life. Like we said, they can hemorrhage and die if quick action is not taken on the children. The constitution also has issues. It has circumstances under which you can kill. If you kill somebody and they go to court and find you guilty, you will be killed. So that is not contravening your right to life. If somebody is killed in the process of catching him when he's running away from offense, that is also. So there are some circumstances, yeah, conditions. Outside this, it is wrong to take another life. Outside this exception, recognized by the Constitution. So, if you are going to perform an operation on a girl that may warrant her bleeding to death, and she dies, some have actually died. Have you not killed her? You've taken her right to life. If she catches HIV/AIDS, when HIV/AIDS was the major killer, are you not killing her? If she gets hepatitis B, which I hear is even more dangerous than HIV, you have killed her. So you can kill directly or indirectly. Now, the right to dignity of the human person, that is section 34. Every individual is entitled to respect for the dignity of his person, and accordingly, no person shall be subjected to torture or to inhuman or degrading treatment. In some communities in Nigeria, like the Ibibios, like I said, they do this thing when somebody is about to get married. By the time the skin has toughened, so she will feel a lot of pain. And people have different thresholds for pain. And when the pain is unbearable, it could bring up other medical issues. And then they said people should not be made to undergo torture. I don't know what constitutes torture more than that girl, that young girl, maybe 20 years, being the clitoris, being butchered, being maimed under there, and all that. I don't know what constitutes more torture. And then, dignity of the human person. She's going to get married. And they call in three women or four. They open her legs to the glare of whoever is present. And then they do the quack surgical operation. Even if it's a little girl, there will also be three or four women. Open her up. Me, when I have a daughter, I don't like people looking at her. It's true. I don't like it. And then these women will rally around, open her legs, and she will be crying, and they will be cutting up. So that violates also the right to dignity of the human person. The right to private and family life. The consummation of marriage is a prerequisite for the subsistence of this marriage. It is so important that a marriage could be terminated if you don't consummate the marriage. For those who go under the infibulation, remember I said they will remove everything. Then they will stitch. They will just leave one small hole for urine and menstruation. So I had a cousin who used to say she has no hole. What we were saying, I don't even know. We just said it. She had to undergo surgery before she could have children, before she could consummate her marriage. So usually what happens is if the man is not so much in love with you, you know, he may feel that you are not there. And that could break up your marriage. Look at right to freedom from discrimination. A citizen of Nigeria of a particular community, ethnic group, place of origin, sex, religion, or political opinion shall not by being subjected to either all those things they will rattle down. This constitution is for administrative purposes for those people out there. They will not follow you to your house. They won't follow you to your house. Now, this is the root of discrimination. Why are you doing it to the females and not doing it to the males? I don't know what else could be chopped off from the male, whether we'll chop off the male organ. But leave one. Don't chop it off. Yes. Don't chop it off. And don't press it down. And don't rub powder, as the case may be. Again, this is to ensure fidelity from her, which is not expected from the man. Is this not discrimination? Okay. The underlying reason being to protect the property of the man in the woman. In all, what is Nigeria's response? What has Nigeria done? There are a lot of these international conventions, covenants, treaties, and so on and so forth. There's Convention on the Political Rights of Women, International Women's Year, United Nations Decade for this and that, Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, and Nigeria is a signatory and has ratified all these things. But what we do is to come back here and put a noose on our neck by Section 12 of the same constitution, that each of these things should go through a normal routine to be made law, which means going through all the houses of assemblies, even those in the north, those in the south, those in the west. And you know how very difficult it is when you want to make a progressive law touching on these things, children or women. Those in the north may not, even some Igbos, there are some progressive Igbo men But those ones may not even know what is happening. They want to know what is happening. But those that want know what is happening, keep it down. Let them, if you want my wife to start going around. As if this sex is in the mind. That is why you will not sleep with your mother. You will not sleep with your sister. You will not sleep with your brother's wife and all that. It's not as if once that thing is there, you go about sleeping. Where will you even get the congenial place to to sleep with anybody? All right, so with these laws, what we're saying is that if Nigeria should domesticate them, then we can go directly and depend on these laws to fight some of these issues. But Nigeria has Section 12 as a problem. Now, national laws. We have the Nigerian Constitution, which I've already discussed how it has protected. We have the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act, VAP, 2015. This was under Jonathan. This VAP Act, 2015, was promulgated, but it was only operative in Abuja. States who want it were asked to put it into law. As of today, only 14 states have adopted the VAP Act. So the remaining 22 states have not adopted it. So it does not protect women and children uniformly. Before the VAP Act, some states have promulgated laws to counter FGM. We have Cross River, which made it an offense carrying 3 years or a fine, not less than 10 years. Ebonyi State, they brought in a 5-year prison term for anyone who carries out FGM. Edo State, 3 years imprisonment, a fine of not less than 3,000 or both. Enugu State, Bayelsa State, and the others, they also have imprisonment of 2 years. 2 years. The VAP Act specifically criminalizes FGM and attaches penalty, not less than 4 years or 200,000. Okay, there are some laws too in the north, like Zamfara, and they said no child should be subjected to any form of torture, inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. They did not specifically mention FGM. Then there is HIV/AIDS Anti-Discriminatory Act 2014. It also says no culture, practice, or tradition shall encourage practices that expose people to the risk of HIV infection. FGM certainly does by person-to-person use of unsterilized tools. National Health Act 2014 is also there. The clitoris and part or whole of the labia, which form the crux of FGM, are not replaceable by any means, because they said nobody should remove any part of a person that cannot be replaced. Can't see clitoris being replaced. Now, what are the other actions by the government? Nigeria joined other members of the 47th World Health Assembly to resolve in eliminating FGM. This gave rise to establishment of a multi-sectarian technical working group on harmful traditional practices, conduct of various studies and national surveys, and national policies have also been put in place. Nigeria has also given a level playing ground, a congenial atmosphere for a lot of NGOs who are fighting FGM. So that is also something that Nigeria has done. On my part, what have I done so far? I have 2 books I published, Access to Justice, A Gender Perspective 1 and 2, and both contain discussions on female circumcision. In the PH class, of international human rights law, the topic reproductive rights occupies a prominent position in the course outline. I've made it a point that they write a seminar paper. And from what they discuss, I see they made intense research in this area. We have also been into massive sensitization and advocacy campaigns as activists, especially in the International Federation of Women Lawyers, where I was the Enugu branch chairperson from 2015 to 2018. These advocacies were carried to women in their August meetings. That's where we normally catch a large crowd. We have also collaborated with other groups on many occasions to build strength in what we do. On one of such collaborations, a town hall was held in Faraway Ihamufu. I remember after the normal sensitization, I had a 3-hour, you know, with the women. I stayed with them, a kind of consultation. When it came to FGM, they told me that their husband's word was law. So it's what the husband wants that will happen. And then I also found that half the women were hard of hearing from the slaps they got from their husbands, who were also on drugs, the husband. So when we wanted to meet with the men, the women said they could not go and tell them. So what I did was that as long as I was still the chairperson, every year they were on our agenda until I left. We also did some community policing in a community in Imo State, Avuvu, on female circumcision. I used a women chorus singer who apparently has free access to every gathering in the town. So when she called me that FGM was going to take place, I rushed. Unfortunately, I was held up at Okigwe, so I didn't meet the act. But I was early enough to see the people. I saw them. And they pleaded with me. Like I said, the VAP Act has no room for punishment for somebody who sees these things and does not report. So non-reporting is also a problem. Okay, I forgave them and left. Then when she called me again for another one, I caught them. I was there early enough, so I stopped the practice. I stopped the FGM. The girl's name was Anya Chokia. So I seized some of their instruments, like scissors, like bowls, like a needle that was like that, you know, and I left. They pleaded with me not to report them. So a year after, I went back. I called for the girl. I looked at her and she was still intact. So I knew that I succeeded in that one. Then recently, between 24th and 27th July 2023, we also conducted a little baseline survey in Amanse and Okpono communities on female genital mutilation. In order to achieve a synoptic perspective from the survey, we used 5 women, childbearing age 15 to 49 years. They were randomly interviewed. The interview per person lasted 5 minutes. And our guiding questions were, are you aware of female genital mutilation? How prevalent is female genital mutilation? Do you know of any health implications or social issues arising from FGM? Are you aware of any Anambra State government laws against practice of FGM? The results are here. Table 1, respondents' knowledge of FGM. 60% of the women in Amanse know about it. 40 do not know. 100% of the women in Okpono know about genital mutilation. So the Table 2, response on prevalence. Aman say prevalence is 40 against 60. Opono, 80% prevalence against 20. Although most of those interviewed are aware of FGM, not all know that there are health implications. So Aman say 2 out of 5 said sometimes there is difficulty during child delivery, undue tearing during labor for their victims, excessive bleeding after FGM cut, prone to infectious diseases such as HIV, pains and trauma. None of the women interviewed knows about any government laws in place, so the laws are not even popular. Now, what are the challenges and constraints? A lot of constraints and challenges have militated against the stemming of FGM. There is no federal law prohibiting. You cannot say VAP is a federal law per se. It's a partial domestication into Nigeria. So states that want it will take it. So it cannot be a federal law in that respect. So there is no federal law. The details of anti-FGM are not yet widely known or understood. If you remember when I started, I said some people don't know about it. Some do not care. Some think it's proper. And some have died. Some have suffered. And we're all living together and moving about. The available local framework does not effectively deter the traditional practices because this is a means of livelihood and status in the community. Those women that chop off their clitoris and they are hailed in their communities, yes. And some of them make their living from that. So it's not easy to stop it. The FGM practitioners thrive in the private enclave of their villages and communities. So it's not easy to find them out. A deeply entrenched gender inequality in many communities is also not to be ignored. This has informed the patriarchal nature of the Nigerian culture. Even our laws import our culture into themselves. Some of these laws. For instance, a man dies without a child. The wife is supposed to share his property with a family. Next, a family of the husband, close family. If the woman dies, the man takes everything. And this has been imported into the Anambra state law. It's there. I'm sure the other states also have it. My age. So, you can see that even our culture is in our laws. This constitution, the culture is also part of the problem. Nobody would say yes, but that's what it is. And we are there. The issue of non-reporting of VAP has also affected the operation of VAP that have taken it. In the face of these constraints, the following recommendations are imminent. There is need for states to adopt VAP Act. There seems to be many laws that require harmonization. Sometimes you have an issue. This law provide something ancillary to it. This law provides. No law is touching on it directly. So you keep construing. In fact, if somebody says, what is dignity of the human person? How have I derailed from your dignity? How do you even explain that? And then some people will tell you, our culture is so and so. Some come out to say it. Our culture says this. Why are you using law to stop the issues? So, with all the constraints, challenges, and the ills of the practice, we now ask, in operating, torpedoing, killing beyond existence, this evil practice, why not masculinize the purpose? That's what we say. If you look at this FGM, the consequences are hydra headed. When a woman with the infibulation type gets married, conjugal bliss also erodes the man It's not true. Uh-huh. So, because he can leave the marriage if he wants, but he may love his wife so much, he doesn't want to leave. So, he's also affected. Sociolegal impact is also there. Non-consummation of marriage leaves a spouse the option of avoiding the marriage. This has a great impact on the society. So if you have too many divorce around, it's not good for the society. Some of the victims reject normal relationships because of the stigma of not having a home or of not performing well, and so on and so forth. They even said, even if your baby is 1 kilo, 1 kg, they will give you episiotomy because you went through FGM. So many things. So some babies actually die from bleeding occasioned by female circumcision. And when this happens, a male loses his daughter. A male loses his sister. A male loses his prospective wife, and so on and so forth. So it is not only the females that are affected. Now, a real considerate man that calls himself a man would also feel emotionally drained, emotionally inadequate, if he cannot satisfy his wife sexually. He won't like it. A real man. Never mind those that will rape or not. A rapist does not do it for sexual gratification. A rapist does it because of domination. A rapist is a sick person. He's not there to enjoy. It's not for the woman to enjoy. It's just to show you that he can conquer you. So, just because the excision of the clitoris and other parts of the external genitalia has been reduced to sexual excitement in his wife, from sexual excitement, you need to know the blood vessels that go or that are around that place that they are cutting and cutting off and cutting off. Sometimes we say, do you think it's water that runs through me? For these people, it's not even water that is running through them. Nothing is running, because the blood has been cut off. So since the issue of women has remained trivial in national and community agenda, this is where the plea is now. We are now asking, why not eradicate this evil practice because of the men and not because of the women? So we just ask and we plead that is where we are masculinizing the purpose. The purpose of torpedoing this genital traumatic. Let the purpose be for the men, the victims, and the society at large, since it affects all these. I will make some appreciations. The Almighty God, the author and finisher of my faith, all of us. He it is that makes all things possible. May his glorious and wonderful name be praised now and always. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, thank you for the opportunity given to me to present this inaugural lecture. Like I said before, you have consistently and doggedly sponsored and supported this program. God bless you, sir. Former Vice Chancellor, Professor Abrasion Anyogu, I'm just thanking you for being here for me. Thank you so much, sir. Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration, I think he has left. Thank you, sir, for your efforts. You people are simply wonderful. special advisor to the Vice Chancellor on legal matters. We are talking about law today. Thank you, Ma, for being here. I thank Professor Ilocho Okafor. He was my two-time supervisor for the role he played. Thank you, Professor Eguatu, my friend. You said you'll be here, and you are here. Thank you. Now to my husband, Zeph, who never for one day stood between me and my dreams. In fact, I used to describe him. I used to describe him as a permissive husband. Okay. Is it a Mexico you people are going this time? I'll say yes, sir. He encouraged, he did nothing but encourage me and support me in all the good things I did, not the bad ones. He sanctioned all my travels in pursuit of my dreams, my husband, my love. Thank you is an understatement. But at this point, I can only say thank you. To my children, Adrian Asika, Angelo Akolisa, Alan Arenzechukwu, Arnold Anayochukwu, and Amanda Adeze Amalachukwu, I thank God for making me your mother. Aside the overriding grace of God, you all make me tick like a clock. I thank all my grandchildren outside and inside. I thank my daughters-in-law and my wonderful son-in-law, Chiemeze. You all are God's gift. I could not have asked for a better family. I say a big thank you to John Obodo of Faculty of Agriculture and an associate of the Center for Sustainable Development, where I was a former director. I'm thanking him for his usefulness and good sense in everything. He was also a major part of the baseline study in Amansi and Ogbono. For my friends and colleagues in the Faculty of Law, I say a big thank you to the blessed faculty. I blow a big kiss to Honorable Justice Professor Lizzie Amoji, Professor Nkechi Opalobi, and Professor Carol Arinzo Mobi for what they each mean to me. My AG, my special friend, thank you. Thank you. I can't thank you enough. I thank Professor Owakwe, the chairman of the inaugural lecture committee, and all the members. My sister, Chief Mrs. Grace Ekechukwu, is here with Ebubedike, her husband. She's representing my siblings. Thank you, Grace. The Anyogu dynasty, Bim Bim is here, Chika is here. I'm thanking you people for giving me a congenial atmosphere to operate. Thank you. Knights and ladies of St. Mulumba, Enugu and Awka Sub-Council, especially Enugu Sub-Council, you are here. Thank you. Thank you, my worthy brothers and sisters. I also thank my dean, the Dean of Faculty of Law. She made this a family outing. If you look around, you see Faculty of Law members. They formed their own committee and started working, doing things they didn't even want me to know. Dean Ma, thank you so much. I am thanking everybody, my students, our students. Thank you so much for doing what you know how to do better. You know, people should be hiring you in their events. So, Dean, you'll be charging. So thank you all who have taken time to come and support me. Thank you, the ICT people. We again thank the Almighty God, who is the beginning and the end. Thank you, and thank you.
Let us appreciate her, please, as we keep clapping. Thank you, and congratulations. Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated, please. Thank you. Thank you. So please, may I respectfully invite the chairman of the inaugural lecture committee, Professor Richard Owapwe, to please come up to invite the vice chancellor for the decoration of the 94th inaugural lecture. Mr. Chair.
Vice Chancellor, sir, may I have your permission to invite you to the podium so you can publicly recognize and decorate the 94th inaugural lecture of Nnamdi Azikiwe University of Awka. Mr. VC, sir. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, on this day, the 9th day of November, in the year of our Lord, 2023, on behalf of the inaugural lecture committee of this great university, we can confirm for you, sir, that Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu has successfully delivered the university 94th inaugural lecture. We kindly request you, sir, to recognize her and decorate her appropriately before physical and virtual audience, and permit her name to be entered into the register of professors who are inaugurated. This is her.
Thank you very much. This is a public recognition of the acceptance of Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu into the League of Inaugural Lecturers of our great Nnamdi Azikiwe University. I hereby, on behalf of the Senate of our great university, on behalf of the congregation and council, publicly inaugurate you, Professor Felicia Azuoma Anyogu, as the 94th inaugural lecturer of our great university. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, and congratulations. Thank you. We'll take just a few photographs, and then thank you and congratulations. Thank you. Please may we inform us that after this, more photographs will be taken at the end of the program. Thank you. And congratulations once more. Thank you. Please, after this, we take other photographs at the end of the program. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. More greetings after. Thank you. DJ, please. Thank you, thank you, thank you. DJ, please. DJ, please. Thank you. Thank you. Please, another round of applause for her. Believe you me, inaugural lectures are very, very wonderful. At least today, I know that there could be trauma. Now that thing, you have to go. Because at times I wonder, I will be sending signal and the thing won't even respond. So there could be trauma there. You know, and it is a good knowledge. You see, I thank you so much for letting us know. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please may we quickly recognize our great participants here present. We thank you for being here. And with the permission of the Vice Chancellor and the Chairman, I want to recognize and appreciate again Professor Joseph Ahaneku, former Vice Chancellor of our university and current Vice Chancellor, Federal University of Science, Abuja. Okay. National University of Science and Technology. Biko kwalo neaka. Thank you. Thank you, sir. And the chairman of the inaugural lecture committee, we salute you, Professor Wapwe. We salute you. The former Deputy Vice Chancellor and current SAVC Legal Matters. Prof, we welcome you and we salute you. Our former Deputy Vice Chancellors here present, we salute you. We also salute Professor Joseph Obuagu, former Provost, Federal College of Education, and former Dean, Physical Sciences. We salute you. You are welcome. Professor Misha Kumenweke, he was here. We appreciate you. Professor and Dr. Ken Wogu, the former Dean of the Faculty of Law, and of course, the Attorney General, former Attorney General of Anambra State and Commissioner for Justice. We welcome you. None. The Attorney General is already out, but she was here. We salute her, Professor Chika Ifemeje. Permit me to appreciate the Dean of the Faculty of Law, our own dear Professor Ogugo Ipeze. We salute you. Professor Stephen Ufaro, Faculty of Medicine, we welcome you, we salute you. Professor Uchenwo Ogugu, Director Linkages, Nnamdi Azikiwe University. Professor Ife Sinachi Gladys Ahaneku, the Dean of Medicine, we welcome you. Professor Donald Okoli, we welcome you. Professor Angela Ufele, Director Academic Planning of our university, we welcome you. Professor Father Ikenga Oriebunam, Professor Eche Adima, Professor Mike Ezenwa, the Vice Chair of this great committee, Professor Prince Amechi Ekunobi, we salute you. Ebunike, we salute you. Professor Angela Obidima, we salute you, we welcome you. We also wish to welcome all the heads of departments here present. We welcome you from the Faculty of Law. Just as I said, ab initio, this is in no particular order because we have the list disjointed, please. We also have Dr. Boniface Enwulum, the Subdean of the Faculty of Law. We welcome you. Professor Amaka Eze, we welcome you. Dr. Amaka Igu, the Head of Department of Private Law. Dr. Chioma Mwabachili, the Head of Jurisprudence and International Law. We welcome you. And of course, I didn't mention that Dr. Ojungwogu is also the Head of Department of Human Rights. We salute you and we welcome you. Dr. Neka Umejiako, HOD Commercial and Property Law, we welcome you. Permit me to also welcome the Knights of Simulumba, Enugu and Awka Sub-Councils, we welcome you. Our Chief and Mrs. Ekechuku, we say welcome. Chief Onyejiekwe Osakwe, we welcome you. Chris Obwaji, we welcome you. Bibian Anyogu, we welcome you. Chika Anyogu, we welcome you. Chief Monyelo, we also welcome you. Chief Nonyelo, I salute you. That's Professor AU's elder or eldest brother. We welcome you to this event. I'm sure that we might have other names that we didn't mention, but please permit me and grant me the grace to stop here in order to enable us to move forward. It's even like I'm forgetting my name, and I won't do that. I'm Professor Frank Collins Okafor, a university orator. I thank you for coming. I thank you again and again. Please may I humbly invite Professor Josephat Obuagu, a member of this great committee, to come forward for the vote of thanks. Prof.
Good afternoon, everybody. My V-sister, whenever I see you in Nnamdi Azikiwe lecture, I know it's the special one because you don't attend all of them. Obvious reasons, anyway. You know how busy you are. But when I see you in an inaugural lecture, I know it's a special one. So I must congratulate the lecturer for being able to have the Vice Chancellor present. I also noticed that your husband has been one of us. I've known the face all the time, but I've never been able to put the face and the person together. Oga, thank you. Asna onyomo buago, ane nena agwe bulu, ane nena onyomo bulago. Agu kiri bulu, odogu kiri. Congratulations. My VC Emeritus, Milioma, is your home, was your most welcome. The Dean of Law and former DPCs, my Oga, Professor Ifediora, my worthy brother, worthy junior, and so many things. Professor Rob Iwatu, my DVC Emeritus. Welcome, sir. everybody present, Chief Nonyalo from the Nonyalo family, distinguished lecturers of the Faculty of Law, it's your day. Former Attorney General and Commissioner for Justice, Oli Akwanye, and my sister, no. Professor Ken, Mwog. You see, you cannot remove all those things. I want to refer you, let me refer you to what Professor Konjo Iwala said. She said, there's nothing like all those struggles. And you know what she did today? She has been able to use chemistry to engineer law. She mentioned the meaning, she tried to explain the meaning of torpedo, the chemical weapon, a bomb, using the bomb to attack the clitoris. And that's the problem. So it is chemistry, law, nexus. I thank God I witnessed this lecture. I once discovered you studied chemistry, 1983, a long time ago, and you were teaching chemistry, and had the humility, because Oga said you should do that, to go and study law. You're a good wife. It's not about talking about human rights. It's about having a good family, a good woman in the house. You see how Oga looks younger and younger every day, because he has a home. Dean of Medicine, distinguished MN, I'm sorry. I nearly missed acknowledging your presence. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to waste our time. I want to thank everybody for being present. I am told to give vote of thanks on behalf of the Committee on Inaugural Lecture. My VC, sir, let me say again, the special day, special lecture, that's why you're here. I say it again, and I'll say it next time. Yes. Thank you. My former colleague Dean. Thank you, everybody. I hope I'm not missing much. Thank you, and God bless everybody. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please, may we put our hands together for Professor Obuago. Thank you. The debate continues. You see why inaugural lectures are, really good. People understand it from different perspectives. Obuago said that he understood it from the point of bomb being dropped somewhere. You get it. Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, sir, distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, please may I respectfully invite SAVC and the former Deputy Vice Chancellor of our university, Professor Carol Arinze Mobi, to lead us in the closing prayer. The day.
I don't want to say that this is a quasi sabotage, to stop me from saying one or two things, but I will do the closing prayer. Let us thank God for today, for his goodness, and for his fantastic job he's doing in this university. We thank God for our Vice Chancellor. Thank God for our Vice Chancellor and his foresight, who decided to fast track the inaugural lecture. We thank God that Professor Anyogu is in our presence today. It's not by his might, but because of God's love. And we thank God for the lives we are all enjoying today, and the food, health, and security. And we pray Almighty God to continue to guide UNISIC, defend and protect all of us as he takes us to our different destinations. We have prayed in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you. the university song. Thank you. We take the recession led by the Vice Chancellor. The Vice Chancellors, thank you. The inaugural lecturer, please, you join. Then professors, associate professors, senior lecturers, lecturers too. Lecturers one, lecturers two, assistant lecturers, thank you. Hello. Hello, please may we be reminded that we'll come back to the hall for the cutting of the cake after session. Please.